Commissioners.
How are you?
Good.
We're here today to present a distinctive sidewalk project for MoMA. We're here with DSR, Kinsler, and RGR Rankin. Charles is going to do a presentation.
Hi, Charles, we're in for a little scope video. We're in for thanks for hearing us today. It's been a crazy day already. You all know where MoMA is. 53rd Street, we're talking about between 5th and 6th Avenues. The application is for this distinctive sidewalk along the entire stretch of MoMA. And if I go too quickly, just stop me. Here are some of the sidewalk conditions that are around MoMA. You can see absolutely rough black granite, unpigmented concrete, and some other granite around, mostly across the street. We did put in a mid-block crosswalk during the course of construction, so it will remain. These are some of the conditions on the north side of the street, the MoMA side. Most importantly, the red granite at the museum tower, which was put in the mid-80s. Absolute black granite is already underneath the water lobby entrance, the circular entrance of MoMA. There are steel curbs and there's some bluestone and some various other stones, so sort of a hodgepodge of conditions. Here are other conditions. This is showing the second slide and shows the red granite at the museum tower. One of the conditions we're fighting a little bit is just the kind of the collection of vendors that happen in front of MoMA. It's not such a nice thing, but also there's unpigmented concrete as well. Yeah, here are some of the issues we're trying to combat, which is we're trying to pull together several decades of construction that is one institution. We're trying to distinguish our entrances, our two primary entrances now, which MoMA will have when we reopen. Of course, to unify the sidewalk and to give this very distinguished institution presence that is somehow collected into one kind of continuous gesture. And we're trying to, of course, make the visual clutter on the sidewalks a little less problematic. So, five buildings, 80 years. We're trying to very simply unify all of these buildings into one kind of collection. And the sidewalk is our the best place, in fact, to do this. So this is the expansion. You recognize the existing entrance, and then some renovations to the Taniguchi project, which goes from here until here. And then this is a new building at 45, and then we extend into the Jean Nouvel project. We're talking about the sidewalk that would end at the end of the new build at 45. Our goal with this project is really to unify it with the city much more, to open it up, to make the ground floor free of charge, or bringing back the project room, which is something that we as designers really missed and implemented. We had a project there, and you can get there free of charge. So the way that the museum works with the sidewalk and with the street is will be very different. And actually, you'll also notice that we've lowered the bookstore down the floor, so you can see right into the bookstore. One of the reasons we think distinctive paving would be acceptable is it exists in a lot of institutions around the city, including Times Square, which just opened. Two Palm Circles demolished, but it had a very distinctive sidewalk. Guggenheim as well. So institutions that are kind of like minded institutions have distinctive sidewalk. And our idea is really simple. It's that we'd like to essentially mark the kind of architectural gestures of the two canopies, the existing Durrell stone canopy, which is circular, and then a new canopy that we're adding at the main entrance, which is rectangular. The idea is that it's simply a shadow cast on the ground that marks these two entrances and uses materials that are already there. And so the two entrances in this, you can see them here, The Lauder lobby here with its Doral stone canopy would just simply cast that the shadow, in quotes, onto the sidewalk, and then a new canopy, stainless steel canopy that we're putting in at the main entrance at 53 would just be essentially the same outline as the canopy above. We're also doing, would like to propose some other elements. So here are the shadows, absolute black granite, and essentially matches exactly the shape of the existing canopy. This one is set back just a tiny bit from our canopy, but essentially operates as if it were kind of shadow on the sidewalk. Some of the other elements that we're proposing include a continuous granite curb, granite surrounds on the tree pits, some other street furniture, some new street furniture as well. I'll go into that in more detail. And so this is the entire strip stretch of the sidewalk, west side, east side. And this is the existing situation. I won't want to talk about that too much unless you need to see it. And so this is the new situation where there's a continuous strip of granite curb. And it goes all the way down to the end of 45, which ends here. The tree pits, these are existing tree pits that we were going to remake, and they would be, they would have granite surrounds, new uplighting, city ordained bike racks in several locations down the street. And we'd also like to paint all of the utility elements, these guys that are existing black. The palette is intended to be sort of tone on tone. This is pigmented sidewalk. It would be essentially it's a cool call it black, but it reads as gray. And we have some samples here on the table. So this is pigmented concrete here, and then the black granite is this. So essentially, it's tone on tone. They're very similar in nature. They would have slightly different reflective qualities. You can also see that we would be cutting into the concrete a pattern that reflects a kind of street furniture that kind of takes a patterning up to the window wall. Some details, the black granite curb, the existing utility elements painted black, the tree well with the absolute granite surround lights on the trees, and then the gray pigmented concrete. We would also like to include behind the property line a strip of black granite as well, tying both linear elements together. This is what that would look like. The tree pits are, the tree wells are all existing. I believe we're not adding a new one here, they're all existing. The kind of material quality is a sort of tone on tone. Pigmented concrete and absolute black granite. And bike racks would be city ordained bike racks. You can see there are five locations down the street here, there, here, here, and here. They're oriented perpendicular to the curb, but they are within the zone of the trees. So essentially, that edge is a kind of dense zone with different kinds of utility and bike and tree equipment. And then the street trees, on 53rd Street we had calorie pear trees, and we'd be replacing them with the Chinese elm trees. Chinese elms are what have been used on 54th Street to great success. And so we would be proposing to take the Chinese elm trees onto 53rd Street as well, and in existing locations. Sorry to go so quickly, so we'll get through it. So the Chinese elms look like this, the pear trees are like that. The Chinese elms have a beautiful fall color, and they are blooming, fairly common tree to see around. And I don't know a ton about the plant detail, but I understand that this helps the plants grow.
Yeah, so it's a system of silver cells so that we get more root volume beneath the sidewalk.
Nice.
So the trees can grow better and larger.
And then the last point to be made is simply behind the property line, and I've said this already, we'd be adding a strip of the narrow absoluto black granite to tie into the curb that parallels the street. And that's what we have for you today.
Perhaps the black granite curb meets, I'm just because I guess I should have gone and looked. Where you've got the pink granite, the black granite curb, and then you've got another bit of the pavement, the colored concrete, way over, keep going. That's your black granite that goes all the way to your cut line?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's then what, no more black granite, or I just don't know.
So the curb actually continues. Sorry, I didn't make that point. It starts behind the church right here.
Right.
Just begins and it continues in front of the Duval building. Is that correct?
Well, the size of what we're proposing right now stops at, we stop at the west property.
So it's just that, it's just the MoMA.
The MoMA.
Right.
The black red curb.
I think this is not drawn properly here. That should be.
Not.
It stops at before the tower.
Before Duval's tower,
okay.
Right here.
And then the gray on the side of the pink is not your gray, it's some other gray.
It's the same. They're actually.
They're using the same gray.
Oh, you're using the same gray, so then that's.
Yes.
Okay, that's
yeah.
Just.
Yeah, this it's the Heinz tower is using the same gray, standard gray.
This one.
Right, that Davis color. They're using the same color. We're not sure what they're doing with their curve.
Thank you. Sorry. The slides are very quickly, but I did quickly catch there was a reference that the use of one of the granites people used invoked, which I didn't understand, the FDR.
Sorry, I was trying to get through everything. I know this time is a little crunchy.
Okay, I just wanted to understand what the relationship was. Why? I just saw that quickly. NYC president, what, FDR? What's, I didn't quite get.
So you're talking about the pigmented concrete or
the round body?
I'm wondering the relevance. Or what the importance.
It's just where it's been used.
Yeah, just
the location where it's
been. Is that the only point?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions, and I can leave it on any slide if you have more.
This is a good one, I think.
Yes.
Would you like to start with the big picture?
Well, the bigger picture is in general, the commission, particularly this particular point in time, is, I would say, resistant to distinctive sidewalks that are overly complicated and sort of distracting from the ordinary way in which people enjoy the sidewalks, which are public property. So our tendency has been to sort of ask those for whom distinctive sidewalks are important and which we're likely to approve to maintain a sort of simplicity to the sidewalk that creates the impression that you want without going too far.
Sure.
And by too far, we believe you get into what is critical historically to this commission, and that is visual clutter. The idea that there's too much going on in a pedestrian's mind, that he's really not understanding exactly what it is you clearly want to project with your design, which is, this is MoMA, and it is a distinctive and important New York City public institution, and the entrances in a confusing street with a lot going on could be and should be marked. So I guess the thought, and everyone will have a view, the thought is that in many ways the idea is fine, but you've gone too far with too many things going on, too many demarcations, too much, you know, an overly active scoring, black granite under the bike racks, painting the utilities and marking the utilities. I think it calls greater attention to the public space that is necessary for a person to understand what it is you want them to understand, which I think is a logical. Am I summarizing reasonably well what people had articulated earlier? So we can give you a bunch of specifics. I've named a couple of them. People have had other ideas. But, you know, It's certainly like everything you guys do, it's really elegant, but I think it's much. Too much. It's definitely much, and I guess our view is it's too much. So we might ask at this particular stage to sort of say, okay, what are the elements that are essential to doing what it is we want to do, and what of them are just cool, or just sort of interesting, or not done before, or whatever, that we would urge you in our role as someone who wants to simplify and people's enjoyment of a consistent public, you know, environment, we would ask you to sort of tone down or eliminate. That would be, I think, our view on this. And people have very specific things.
Well, I think it's great that you're cleaning this all up.
Yeah, but not totally, right? Because we're leaving the pink sidewalk in front of.
I guess you can't lose the pink.
Well, you probably could if you had to, but leaving that aside, let's assume you don't.
I mean,
let's assume you don't. Okay, you don't wall, whatever. That's
we can't. We can't. We can't touch that, unfortunately.
So the big moves are the refacing the sidewalk, the new curb, the canopy to identify the entries, and then you have the new trees. I mean, all that's really elegant. I guess you know it's dead where you stop.
Sure.
Right. So I think the bike racks look great. I love those bike racks.
Yeah, they're great. We should have what you're
personal best. But I think the question is, do you then highlight all the
each individual
individual things that could
right.
You okay. Know, I think there's concern about that yeah. Change. And so then the scoring though, which is coming off of that, I mean it could actually help them because if things change, you've got a kind of scoring in there. Mm-hmm. That would allow for mm-hmm. Something.
That's good.
You know, that's a kind of grade, you know, okay, there's something small, we have to take it out. The tone is probably what I would object to more. But I mean, this is a group of, you know, various kinds of people, so.
The tonal difference between the two?
The tonal difference under the bike rack and
I see. Okay.
You know, the fire hydrants. Like, that's the question, where do you stop?
Yeah,
you,
yeah.
Right? The darker branch.
Sure.
So hierarchically, you know, there's two big guys, the two doors, right? And
yeah,
then there's
that's
strip
right.
Along
right.
The building, and there's the curb. Right. And then it's, I mean.
And those elements, those four elements,
yeah.
I think are great. And maybe
we can stop.
I mean, maybe you won't, but that would be our guidance to look at that possibility of, you know, I love the strip against the building. I know that's not us, it's you, so that's great. I happen to like the granite curb. I think that's lovely and carefully demarking. Happy to do, you know, the sidewalks. I mean, I think there's a lot that's good.
But I will say, I think that your precedent images, I would not include Times Square because that's blocks of space, of the two museums. And the diagram very carefully showed interior expressing itself in the exterior. You've now chosen to pick the most mundane street furnishings and respond to that, including sidewalk grates, onto the architecture, which I feel is going completely the wrong direction. It's one thing to express the canopy, which I'm in complete
yeah,
support.
I think right.
And, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, you're basically trying to scream louder than the residential tower, which is unfortunate, and one of the reasons that,
you don't like
as a commission in general, we don't like distinctive sidewalks.
And didn't approve that.
It just, yes, we didn't approve it. But I really think that the scoring pattern is going absolutely the wrong direction, both in terms of what it's responding to, and it is doing nothing to support the architecture or to create greater coherence among this collection of buildings. Do you have approval, by the way, from those utility companies on painting them black?
No, this is just concept.
Because I'm not sure that FDNY is going to, or DEP is going to approve of painting a gas facility. But anyway, I just think that the street is the street. And all that, all those utilities are what they are. They come and go, they add more. And your sidewalk should not be driven by these phenomenally mundane utilities.
I think I've got the question. What's the building that's on the corner that's existing?
Church?
The church?
Is the other
CBS, yes.
Across the street.
CBS is across the street.
Sorry. Let me go back to.
There's just to the west of MoMA is the Johnny Bell Hines residential tower.
Oh, that's.
And then just to the west of that, on the corner, is an office building.
So do those have custom paving as well?
The Hines Tower will have the same standard gray concrete with standard flat-by-flat flat.
Okay, sure. Because I think one of the things that we've had in the past is a question of how does it integrate with the rest of the buildings on that same street? Of course, with the cathedral, maybe there's a limitation, we showed that. But I think one of the things that Sydney was talking about is just how it relates to the rest of the environment. And I love it. And I think having a more open space for the public to be engaged is really critical and important. I think thinking long term and larger, I think there are ways in which you're not going to be able to avoid the vendors setting up on the street. And there are also things that might actually work against it if it doesn't actually seem to pay attention to what else is going on the east and west sides of the same street, and even to some degree across the street, because it is a place where so many people come together.
Well, they're trying to with all the bike racks, and even to vendor proof their facade, but
not going to happen.
Not going to happen.
I think it's going to add more clutter, but I mean, I agree. I like the trimming that's adjacent to the building. I don't know if the curb one is going to. I think we've seen sort of a brush stopping at a certain edge, especially since it has a distinctive tone to it. I like the canopy, and I think that adds up as well to bringing pedestrians or people who come to the museum to understand that's like where you're going. But I'm not sure if the curbside trim would make sense for the entire block, because it just sort of abruptly. And since there's no way to sort of curb it in, modulate it to the design.
It's kind of one of the particular problems of building and infill building in New York City generally, you know, that it just begins and ends.
Yeah, I mean, and I agree. I don't think that that should extend to the utility as well.
Right.
It's almost like, what if the city decides to take whatever utilitarian thing is there and move it somewhere else, and you have this, you know, square on the street that not no longer.
You guys seem pretty unified about that, so that would be buying racks and some, like.
I think it does to add.
And the scoring associated with
sure.
The
right, yeah.
I think what you've done in some ways commendably, but you've asserted the superiority of your unified design over some of the features of the public sidewalk. I mean, you've brought it together, and you've asserted we're MoMA, and we dominate this street, and oh, by the way, it looks better. And it doesn't quite look better in some respects, even though we all respect MoMA. And I am cautious in a different way, but echoing some of what my colleagues said. I don't think you should treat the utilities as you have. There are many questions which others have said, that's not appropriate at all. The features against the building, the canopies and the granite are all assets, I think, in terms of what you are doing for the block itself. The bike racks, I guess, are okay too. You use the word a number of times of street furniture. I thought at first before you were showing the slides that you were including in that, are there going to be benches or people sitting? I was confused about what you meant by furniture. And initially I thought, oh, MoMA's going to add some help to the public with the lines there. But okay, you didn't do that. So I think that that you should really look again, and it really is questionable about the curb, the utilities. I think you should stick with what you were trying to achieve in unifying the entrances, making them more accessible to the crowds and public by the canopies and so on, and not do the other features, which are really quite intrusive and controlling by MoMA, and the block has other things on it.
Tree wells typically have different grading on them,
right.
And so you're not talking about the tree wells, you're just talking about these guys, these next
Because I just understand that Sydney knows everything about this and I don't. When you said that you chose to change the trees.
Oh, that's great. Well,
that's
great.
Yeah,
that's
just
all wonderful.
Okay, I just want to
use the silver cells.
Okay, good. As, if that's, okay, just, okay, fine.
I guess a question, would you be able to collaborate with the Jean Nouvel development and the other to extend the curb?
It would be nice to do that.
Yeah, it seems so.
I mean, I think that I would feel, and I suspect others would feel, that if you weren't just demarcating your own property, I understand respecting the church because it's a bluestone tradition and blah, 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 and it has its own very distinctive sidewalk going from that property line all the way to the curb tangent.
Right.
If you could accomplish that, I think we would accept the thick. I mean, it's a very elegant treatment. We see it on Broadway, Lower Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
It does give the sidewalk a sense of, you know, real urbanity, but not just to define it properly.
So unfortunately, our representative from MoMA was ill today, and she would be the one who could answer that. That's certainly something we could look into.
Yeah.
There's a relationship.
That's all we're asking.
I mean, it's good for them.
We agree with that. I mean,
that's why I think there was a slip in our studio. It's like that.
Yeah.
Like it was to go down there and.
Yeah, I think that's just the connection. I thought also it helps for people from the Sixth Avenue side.
Yeah.
Right. They know they're on.
Yes.
Okay.
So just one thing about the.
Scoring
because the overhangs shadow come from the building proper, so the scoring is coming from something else, and there's going to have to be some kind of scoring because there has to be a control joint. So
I will point out that the scores are it is all related to the.
No, I'm not advocating that everything is to emanate from it. So what they're doing is they're trying to find something else to break it up, which I actually appreciate. Rather than every building having to kind of imprint itself on the sidewalk with some kind of scoring pattern. So they're finding some variation that has a smaller scale that creates a different pattern across the sidewalk. I for one thing is fine because if you start to look at, oh, I'm just going to take the building column over and then I'm not going to do this one. So then they all of a sudden there's a problem. You're going to have the tree pit sitting in something, or you're going to have to deal with the corner of the concrete. And, you know, I mean, of course, we see that everywhere in the city, but I think it allows for these elements we know are going to be there to actually be detailed.
Well, I don't mind expressing it's almost artistic in a Duchamp kind of way what you've got going there on the sidewalk. But it's just, thank you. It's just not yet fully worked out, and I think that once you downplay the utilities, establishing whatever rhythm that you want to express would be a good idea. I was just simply pointing out that the precedent images are the reverse of what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Not that that's bad.
I'm with you. I get it.
Okay.
Thank you.
The new Westchester Square Library will be located at the northeast intersection of Lane Avenue, Westchester Avenue, and Overing Street, in the historic neighborhood of the Bronx. Sorry, I'm a little ahead of myself. Situated at the entrance to the neighborhood's main commercial area and adjacent to the Westchester Square East Tremont stop on the elevated 6th subway line, the new library will serve as a beacon and cultural hubs of the neighborhood. The surrounding area to the east is predominantly residential and commercial and industrial to the north and south. Here's some additional views of the area and the project site.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but you can just skip forward to, since we've seen this before, as presented. You want to just kind of skip forward to the update since we received your last approval?
Sure, sure. So as I'm clicking through these, I just wanted to point out the density of trees in the area. On the left is the existing site plan, and on the right is the proposed site plan. This area is unique because of its dense vegetation and its park-like setting. The architect's concept was to merge the canopy of trees into the design elements of the architecture. The building is meant to feel like a treehouse in an extension of the existing canopy. The artwork will be installed on the second floor of the new library. Most of the sculptures will be centered around the storytime area on the second floor. In keeping with the architect's idea of keeping the green nature to the space, Convergence is a flock of 100 pixelated birds suspended from the ceiling throughout the second floor of Convergence of the Children's Storytime area. With my work, I create three-dimensional sculptural representations of two-dimensional images of nature I find online. So for my process, I start with a source image, and then I lower the resolution, and then I do a hand drawing on graph paper. And then next I cut strips of wood, and then I hand dye it with hundreds of colors, and then I assemble the sculpture piece by piece, pixel by pixel. To tie this installation to the local community, I've been talking to the New York Audubon Society to learn more about these local birds that call this area home. And keeping with my process of sourcing images online, I utilize the New York Public Library's extensive digital collection of 19th and 20th century images of nature. Convergence will be made up of a series of 20 different local songbirds with a wide array of pattern shapes and vibrant colors, primarily red, orange, and yellow, to contrast the library's blue and green baffles and dark charcoal ceiling. This is a reflective ceiling plan. The birds will be placed to show movement through the space, and there will be a few on the stairwell that would act as an introduction as one walks up the stairs. By concentrating the greatest density of birds and the southernmost corner of the building, the artwork will create a visual impact that contrasts the architecture and be visible from across the street when passing six trains. At a distance, the flock will appear to have its own defined shape, but up close, you will see that they're made of individual birds. This is a view from the children's storytime area looking back through the library. You can see the stairwell here. And this is a view from the help desk looking back towards the storytime area. Here is a view of the ceiling showing the acoustic baffle system and colors. The birds will be placed between the baffles, so when you're looking up, the vibrancy of the birds will provide a contrast with the dark charcoal ceiling. Here are the coordinates for each bird. The contractor will use these coordinates as installation points for installing the brackets that the birds will hang from. There's a corresponding chart showing which species of birds will hang at which point. Each bird will be made of basswood, which is American hardwood. Each bird will be constructed from approximately 2,500 pieces of wood, all together with wood glue and 23-gauge pin nails. This model here was created with natural undyed strips of wood, but in the proposed artwork, each piece would be hand-dyed using light bastings, excuse me, in color and coated with UV protectant. This is a model of the northern cardinal. Each bird would vary in shape depending on species. Each bird would be suspended by two black steel aircraft cables that are attached to hidden eye bolts embedded in the backs of the birds. The flock would hang just below the library's baffles, which are approximately 10 feet above the floor. To make the artwork feel more dynamic, the birds would be installed at various heights to suggest movement and flight, no less than 9.5 feet above the floor. The the birds would be clipped to brackets that would be attached to the ceiling for ease of installation. And there would be a second set of clips that would allow birds to be individually removed for building maintenance. The cables, clips, brackets, and ferrules would all be black to minimize their visibility against the ceiling. And then, since this is a mock-up of a hanging system, and which I have here, and I would manufacture the steel brackets, which I would give to the installer, and they would install them as part of the capital project construction. And when I install the birds, I would be able to swivel the bracket at the installation to get the correct angle and maximize the visibility. These are some molecular plastics I would be working with. Just sort of point out that this is just a sample color palette that I can make these together between hundreds of different colors. So these are my 20 fabrication drawings for all 20 birds, including a source image and a color sample. And the color samples are here and laid out. This is an American goldfinch going all the way down to the vireo. Please note that each bird is made up of hundreds of colors, and that there will be color variation from bird to bird just as color nature. In keeping with my process I showed you earlier, the source image acts as an inspiration. From where there, I've lowered the resolution and created the graph drawings at the bottom. And each block in the graph paper represents one colored piece of wood. The drawing acts as a guide to determine the overall shape of the bird. The wing position will vary between birds. Some birds will be up or down, or forwards or backwards, so that there would be no two exact like birds. This is the American goldfinch. There will be four of these in the installation, and no two birds will look exactly alike. This is the American redstart. There are three in the installation. This is the smallest of all the birds. I've increased the size of the birds in the design by about 40% because some of the birds are quite small in real life. There are six American robins. This is the largest bird in the installation. Eight Baltimore Orioles, four Bay-breasted Warblers, five Blackburnian Warblers, eight Blue-winged Warblers. The Dick Thistle gets its name because its song, which apparently sounds like it's saying Dick Thistle. There will be four in the installation. Four house finches, four magnolia warblers, five morning warblers. In many species of birds, the males and females have very different coloring. With the north, the male and female northern corner, I want to make sure to include this in convergence. The female is predominantly pale yellow with orange and black markings. There will be four. Vibrant red and orange males, five palm warblers. Author, artist Roger Torrey Peterson famously described the purple finch as a sparrow dipped in raspberry juice. There will be four of them. There will be six rose-crested grosbeaks. Rose-crested grosbeaks have amazing singing ability. They sound like robins or off the tree. Like the cardinals, the male and female scarlet tanager are completely different colors, so I want to be sure to include both of them. There are four females and six males. With the summer tanager, I've chosen to go with the juvenile male with his yellow and red orange molting patches of color. Thus, as he matures, it will become more solid red, the only solid red bird in North America. There will be four of them. And finally, the yellow-throated vireo, there will be four. The plaque would be attached to the glazing at the top of the stairs on the room side of the glass. It would be black ink printed on matte white high-performance vinyl. Maintenance would be minimal. Periodic dusting is needed, and the manual low suction vacuuming. I've been working with an art conservator who's developed a detailed plan, a detailed report, excuse me, that is included in my submission materials. Thank you.
I mean, I think we've always loved this project, and it's gotten even better, and the comments we made about maintenance and all the rest of the things, you've done a brilliant job in solving, and it's fascinating to see your process. I guess the one sort of question we had was, you keep describing the birds as being displayed against a charcoal coffered ceiling, yet the ceiling we're seeing in the presentation is a very vibrant, multicolored green ceiling. It's
the baffles.
The baffles. Is that your ceiling design?
No, the baffles are about 18 inches apart.
Right.
So this is about 16 or so. So I think it's sort of like the baffles are on either side.
Right.
And maybe my shirt's the charcoal ceiling, so the bird's against it, and there's a baffle on a baffle. But
the baffle is like the green of the trees. That's the concept of it.
The color of the baffles are basically taken directly from the frit.
From the
thread. Yes.
Do you want to go back to this?
Yes, could you? That's the only slide that any of us have any issues or questions. Questions more than issues.
Yeah, well, you had the array of colors for this the baffles.
Yeah, there's another one even. There's a rendering that's even. But this will do it.
I think it's because of the angle of this shot that. From the situ that I'm working with, but the idea is that, so if I'll just use this one as an example of a blocking view, is that this would be hanging, the cables would be coming up between these two colored baffles here.
So I think the question about the colors of the baffles or the colors of the birds, is it something that you feel is working well?
Well, I chose to use these particular birds just because I wanted the red and the warm color palette to contrast the coolness of the green and blue.
You're working with it because it's a contrasting color.
We don't see the blue. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Let me go to. Here's the range.
So those are the color colors, the final colors.
So the other blue ones are actually. So I guess it's the green and the blue, green and blue.
I think there's this. Maybe it doesn't make that much sense, but it feels as though they're flying through the trees rather than from the sky. And so the idea of birds maybe being differentiated from the canopy is like something that we might like, because the green and yellow, although it looks amazing on the outside, I think in a way it takes away from the beauty of the birds because they blend in so much.
They're too close.
Yeah, it's like
the
colors.
The colors. It's like they are almost camouflaged. So it's less about the birds than it is about the ceiling.
I think the birds and your body are beautiful. I think it's really, really well read and beautifully designed. I think that considering the panel colors on the top, it feels like it's taking away because they're just as vivid. You know what I mean? So I'm not sure if there's a way to shift.
I guess everyone wants to know, do you like the ceiling with your piece?
Not that the ceiling is your design, we understand that's separate from the artwork.
I'm just curious, because.
But does it work? Are you comfortable that the ceiling is compatible, a compatible background or a sympathetic background to a work of art that we, you know, at the commission just think is fantastic? Or is it competitive or
Not to put words in your mouth.
And we're fine if you say it's great, then we want to respect what you want to do, so we don't want to put words in your mouth.
Because we didn't see the ceiling last time.
Yeah, we didn't see the ceiling. We saw your fabulous birds, and the birds have gotten better, and your thinking is amazing, and going to the library and the whole thing. It's all great. It's just the ceiling's like, I don't know, I want to see more of the birds and less of the ceiling, personally. But if you're comfortable, I think we can be comfortable.
I think the space between the baffles and the darkness between the baffles, I think is what makes it work. And I do agree that it does feel like they are flying through the trees. I think that's kind of like the whole building sort of feels like anyway, because there's like a tree and a building and a tree, and it's like they're all this conversion through. So I guess that's kind of my roundabout answer of saying I'm okay.
guess you've worked out the lighting so it's not right above a bird.
Yeah,
you
it's
know,
pointed.
I can see the ceiling fan.
And actually, Sean and I, the ceiling was there before the artwork, obviously, mm-hmm. in one way. But we worked together really closely to understand the two readings, two scales that exist. There's one, there's the field, the full ceiling, and then the birds below it, contrasting. Mm-hmm. And then standing right underneath the bird and seeing the bird up against the black air. So you can really focus on the bird.
Yeah, in the section you see there's a light fixture.
Correct.
And then a baffle and then a bird. So the light fixture is never where
it's never,
bird.
Yeah, the birds
never
are placed.
Coincide.
Correct. The birds are placed in a way that they don't hang right below the light. So.
Do you want me to go back to like the overall?
You had a section.
Well, I just have one question before you switch. It would be nice to see this gradient more on the other side. I like the gradient, but it just seems that the cooler colors could really complement the work. Is that that's just a suggestion, but
actually the idea was the main focus of the space is the sharp corner with the story time area pointing towards the train. So that. And that was kind of the reason why we chose to orientate the baffles this way. They're also cutting off light at the corners, so they're acting.
We just have the shades. Colors.
And then the colors too. On the outside, the greenest corner is really on the baffles over there. So it will be difficult to flip the green without changing the full design.
Okay.
Okay.
So they go to the section then, maybe.
Which one of these is the
one
that
shows the detail
section?
This one. Detail section.
Keep going.
The other way.
Was it the other way?
Yeah, we have to go the other way.
There
are the lights.
Oh,
there
are the lights.
There are the lights.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then there's a section that shows the. I'll probably go back one, I guess.
Back one.
Or is it?
Forward. Now there was one that had a section of the baffle with the light fixture.
It was in detail.
So the light fixture is up.
It's up. And it never goes there. It's a bird.
And the bird is always
below. Yes.
And the thing that's purely horizontal is always gray, correct? What's
the ceiling?
The ceiling.
I had that right.
So if you're looking straight up, you do see the bird against the gray, which is how you articulate it.
Yes.
What's painted is the vertical baffles.
Here.
Got it.
Okay.
That's a.
Well, fundamentally, we just wanted to be sure
that you're okay.
That you're okay with it, because as was expressed earlier, we had not seen this color scheme. And so if you feel that it's been a good collaborative process,
we're good. Southeastka, it has been a great collaborative process,
right.
But one thing I just want to point out is I think with the variance of color, so that they're not the exact same stamp of every single bird, I think there's going to be some undulation and some thinking that's going to be done when I'm building the birds
mm-hmm.
about what colors are going to be working with. Baffles that are
with
there.
The ceiling.
Because when I know two birds are going to look the same,
right?
And so there's going to be some that are going to have maybe a little more yellow or might a little more red or, and I throw little things in there.
Correct.
My little games. That's great. So.
Yeah, that'd be beautiful. It's a beautiful piece.
The building's
beautiful too. Sorry, it's a great book. Great book.
Public meeting is an advertisement with the consent agenda. We're going to items 26408 to 26445. So, trust you've all read this and noted the conditions of approval as recommended by the various committees and excuses. Remarkably, this month there are no refusals, but did we overlook any of them? All right. For the record, there are no refusals at all. And no members of the public have signed up to testify. Anyone here wish to testify? No. So someone make a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second. All in favor, please raise your right hand. Thank you. We have unanimous approval